Bom dia! Graça e paz de Cristo. La grâce et la paix de Christ. Grace and peace of Christ be with you all. I bring you warm greetings from Redcliffe College, the United Bible Societies, and the World Evangelical Alliance. It's an honor to be here with you. I'm from São Paulo, Brazil, so special greetings to all those Portuguese speakers out there. And special greetings to Table 16 and our wonderful leader, Seble. Yes. At Redcliffe, we have so many students just like you, people involved in all sorts of work, leading busy lives, who want to take a little time to think deeper and more carefully about their life of discipleship and their work. It was a joy for me yesterday to meet one of our new students. I'm not sure where you are. One of our new students, and to connect with others who might be interested in starting the program that begins in Thailand later this year. Redcliffe has a long history with Lausanne. You might have heard of Chris Wright of Langham Partnership and primary author of Cape Town Commitment. Chris's mother went to Redcliffe about 100 years ago. Lausanne catalysts and friends of the movement have been through our doors, not just in the UK, but around the globe. And with the United Bible Societies, it is my privilege to work with amazing people all around the world, including here in the Philippines, who are working so hard against Bible poverty and to make the scriptures accessible to all people so that young and old might grow in wisdom and love of our Lord. I really get to work with some extraordinary people. So, we return to our journey with Daniel this morning. You've heard chapter 2. It's very exciting. But you might be wondering, what does it have to do with creative discipleship, which is our theme for today? So let's think about that together now. Do you know the feeling of waking up frightened because of a horrible nightmare, but then you can't even remember what it was? And what if it were a recurring dream, a dream that comes each night so that you don't even want to go to sleep for fear of the horrible dream? If you've read your biblical text or paid attention to what was read, I bet you're feeling a little sympathy for poor King Nebuchadnezzar. Yesterday, we heard a bit of Daniel's context. He was a prisoner of war, a slave in the king's court. Though a model civil servant, he was also actually quite subversive, challenging cultural and high court dietary rules, praying to a god no one could see in a culture of idols, and undermining the presumed lordship of the Babylonian king. Daniel and his friends were pretty cool. They were also pragmatic and had a long view of history, even under oppression. Theirs was a view of history under God. Chapter 1 began with one king, Nebuchadnezzar of Babylon, and ends with this verse. And Daniel continued there until the first year of King Cyrus. That's how chapter 1 ends. Daniel is a story of a mega history, but not necessarily history as we think of it. Not history as we might talk of the invasion of the Philippines by Magellan of Spain in the 1500s, or the sale of the Philippine Islands to the North Americans in the late 1800s. Not that sort of history. Daniel tells the history of a God who sees kings come and kings go. Empires become strong and empires crumble, but God remains God. Daniel tells the history of a God who stays with his people even in exile, and a God who controls all of that history. Therefore, almost like a footnote, chapter 1 mentions one king at the beginning and one in its last verse. But the kings in all their glory, pomp, circumstance, and oppressive practices are actually so small they warrant only a little verse at the end. This isn't their story. This is God's story. Here in chapter 2, King Nebuchadnezzar is desperately trying to establish his reign and assert his leadership. Any CEOs out there trying to show everyone who's boss? Employees to manage, a board of trustees to please? And night after night, the king has this horrible dream. As any sensible boss, he asks his trusted advisors to tell him what it means. The catch is that they also have to tell him what the dream is, probably because he couldn't remember it. This is a culture that had volumes and volumes on dreams and their interpretations. If our slide works, I'll show you what they didn't get to consult, what these advisors did not get to consult. They didn't have a book of dreams, a dictionary that they could use. The prospect of looking through many of these, next slide, before the king's bedtime, was a bit daunting. Those were their resources, volumes of them. This is the story about the God who is the God of history. God isn't a big old white man in the sky. God isn't the biggest piece of furniture in the universe. God is creator, creator of the universe, creator of time itself. And in this story, as Nebuchadnezzar's sages rightly say in verse 11, the thing that the king is asking is too difficult. No one can reveal it to the king except the gods whose dwelling is not with mortals. But Creator God is indeed with mortals, with his people, with Daniel and his friends, as we find out as the narrative progresses. Daniel and his friends were not in a workplace of their choosing. When they were little boys in Judah, they did not say, "When I grow up, I want to be a eunuch and a slave in a pagan king's court." How many men out there thought that that was your childhood dream? Like many men, women, and children today, Daniel and his friends were migrant slaves, trying to learn to sing the praises of God in a foreign land. Despite the threats, the violence of their situation, the trauma of exile, they persevered. And as the text says, perhaps such perseverance was because they had one another and brought to each other the real concrete challenges of being faithful to God in a most challenging workspace. Creative discipleship is about a lifelong learning of one's context and discerning God's word in that context. You cannot be a creative disciple alone. You need others. It is interesting how in this story, some of the king's other civil servants are named. And they are always named in connection with a conversation with Daniel. Do you know the names of your employees or your colleagues? All of them? In Daniel 1, he speaks with Ashpenaz, and they agree the proposal about the food that Daniel and his friends will eat or not eat. In Daniel 2, he speaks with Arioch, the chief executioner, a wise friend to have and to know by name. Then Daniel responded with prudence and discretion to Arioch, the king's chief executioner. "Why is the decree of the king so urgent?" Arioch then explained the matter to Daniel. You know the story. You heard it. He requested time to give the king an interpretation. Then what did Daniel do? He brought the matter to his friends. Then Daniel went to his home and informed his companions, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, and told them to seek mercy from the God of heaven concerning this mystery. When was the last time you and your home group or church prayer group really wrestled with challenges of the workplace? Can you bring questions about corruption, bribery, the ill treatment of women, about the fear of being fired to your home group? So much of contemporary church is about a feel-good gospel. We work hard all week. I don't want to struggle again when I go to church. Give me something uplifting. I don't want to hear about the corruption in our government. Or why should I do something about the abuse of children in detention camps? But the gospel of Christ isn't a feel-good gospel. It is a transformative and life-giving gospel. From injustice in all its forms to justice, from brokenness to wholeness, from corruption to integrity, from violence to radical love of enemies. Discipleship is the transforming journey of those who say God, not Nebuchadnezzar, is Lord. Being a disciple is also not about being a hero. Daniel is not a hero. His life and the lives of many were on the line. He had some years of experience of praying under persecution and imprisonment. So when it came to this challenge, literally the threat of being executed, Daniel did what a creative and faithful disciple would do. He was wise in seeking counsel from Arioch and finding out exactly what was going on. And he brought the matter before his colleagues so that together they could pray to God. Because again, this is the Creator God who is with his people, even in exile. The harsh realities of injustice and fear in the workplace were brought to this prayer group. Head of gold, feet of clay. That was the king's nightmare. And God gave Daniel both the dream and its interpretation. What did Daniel do after God gave him the vision of Nebuchadnezzar's dream? He didn't first run to Arioch with all the answers. Remember, this is God's story, not the story of mere kings like Nebuchadnezzar. The text says that first Daniel and his friends blessed the God of heaven. Blessed be the name of God from age to age, for wisdom and power are his. He changes times and seasons, deposes kings and sets up kings. He gives wisdom to the wise and knowledge to those who have understanding. He reveals deep and hidden things. He knows what is in the darkness, and light dwells with him. To you, O God of my ancestors, I give thanks and praise, for you have given me wisdom and power, and have now revealed to me what we asked of you, for you have revealed to us what the king ordered. Do those words sound vaguely familiar? Do they remind you of anyone else? In another time and place, not as a slave, but still not working in the best of conditions, a young girl engaged to a carpenter said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked with favor on his servant. The Mighty One has done great things for me, and holy is his name. He has shown strength with his arm and scattered the proud. He has brought down the powerful from their thrones. He has helped his servant according to the promise he made to our ancestors." Mary's words to her friend and cousin Elizabeth. Daniel and Mary, Hananiah, Mishael, Azariah, and Elizabeth. God's people, people of prayer, workers, slaves, visionaries who knew that theirs was the God of history who is also in history with God's people, enabling, encouraging, rescuing, and working in and through the fellowship of friendships and family. Their prayers are not feel-good prayers. They do not cater to what people want to hear, even when that person is the oppressive king. Theirs are prayers born out of lives lived for God alone. If you have any other God besides that God, whether it's the God of the workplace, of money, fame, family, or if yours is a God with a golden head and feet of clay, your prayers won't be like that. And certainly our discipleship will be anything but creative and holy. We learn from Daniel and his friends not to be heroes. We learn to be disciples. We also learn that discipleship requires friends and discernment, paying attention to our contexts and being absolutely honest with each other when challenges arise. There are some questions for your table discussions. You can use these or just talk about how God is speaking to you. You have 20 minutes, not 20 minutes and 30 seconds, not 20 minutes and 5 seconds. You have 20 minutes for your discussions, and may God bless you.